Welcome back. You're still on The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasaja. We are still discussing media freedom with Dr. Peter Mwesige, the Executive Director, African Center for Media Excellency. Doctor, when we broke off, you were going to paint for us a picture of what causes attrition of good journalism, and exactly what are the tenets of good journalism, and what then causes good people. For example, my assumption is that the largest number of people that started the Daily Monitor are probably not there. My own case, many of the people that I left with the university just about 3-4 years ago, 5, that people that were promising are no longer with us, and they have moved on to communication and doing other things. Mm-hmm. What is the cause of this, and what are the tenets of good journalism?
It's interesting you asked about the attrition, because, and you mentioned the monitor and the people who started it, because two of them have been very good friends. Have since passed on. May their souls rest in peace, Richard Tebere and Kevin Aliro. Mm. Others, you know, Wafula Ogutu is in politics, James Serugo is in business, Onyango Obo is still in the business of media. Mm. He's now, you know, a curator of an online outfit. Afripedia and others, the Wall of Great Africans.
Mm.
And then you have some of their first employees, like Linda Nabusayi, who is now President Museveni's press secretary. You have Onapito Ekomoloid, who also was Museveni's press secretary, but is then an MP and is now, corporate affairs director, I think, at Nile Breweries.
Mm.
Others are working in the World Bank. There are those of us who came after them. We are also here and there. So, yes, Uganda, unlike very many countries elsewhere in the world, especially, you know, outside in North America and Europe, doesn't have a tradition of holding on to its good journalists, you know. And I think that's largely to do with not just pay. It's not that journalism doesn't pay very well elsewhere, by the way. Yes, there are celebrities in journalism, like in many other areas, who pay, who earn very, very well. But the rank and file in journalism in the United States, in Europe, in Africa, in Asia, pretty much compared to other people, other professions, they don't really earn that well. So I don't think that the people who leave journalism leave because of poor pay, per se. No. People leave journalism because as they grow older, they discover that it's not maybe giving them the intellectual satisfaction that attracted them to it in the first place. That, you know, a lot of times some of our media houses have, just cover stories, very basic things. Yeah, you don't want to be somebody who, after your master's degree, comes to a newsroom where your job is to say, the president said this, the president added, even when the president is lying, you know, and your job is to say, the president said, the president added, the president reiterated. I don't think that is going to encourage very many people to say. So I think sometimes people leave because that challenge to do the kind of journalism that, you know, changes the direction of history. I don't know if that means, you know, the kind of journalism that, you know, informs and really engages, compelling journalism that, you know, shakes the trees. Is not possible. Sometimes that's why they leave. Sometimes people it's just too much pressure. It's just way too much pressure within this. So if you are going to start a family and you want to be doping your children to school and picking them up every evening, maybe journalism may not be for you at some point. So they are all those things. But I suspect that if our journalism focused on what I consider the principles of good journalism, if our journalism was critical, if it was, if it provided context, analytical rigor, those kinds of things, it asks all the right questions, maybe less people would move away from it. If you felt like, you know, what you do actually matters, maybe less people would move away from it. Not as many people would be moving away from it. But also, we can't, you know, separate the idea of the satisfaction we get from our job from the wider political system. Because if you live in a country where no amount of exposés in the press, in the media, are going to change things, you know, that you are going to come up with all these big stories that amount in the end to nothing, the status quo remains because the responsiveness of those in charge is zero. Then sometimes you're like, what are you doing? What am I up to? Does what I'm doing actually matter? So there are all those questions. It's complicated, but we have seen this going on and on. We are now going to have an election, hopefully, next year. And like we have said it so many times in the past, you can count how many of the journalists who are going to be covering that election have covered more than one election. Why? Because all those others have left. They have moved on. They have gone on here to better playing fields, but also in some cases, maybe in many cases, to fairly satisfying fields.
Yeah. Doctor, could you then paint for us a picture of, as you've described, who is a good journalist?
A good journalist, I think, for me, first and foremost, is somebody who is curious. He wants to understand the world around him. Mm. You know, he's somebody who is inquisitive. He's somebody who listens. He's a good listener. He's somebody who has empathy, who can put himself in the shoes of those he covers and others. He's somebody who has humility, a degree of humility, you know. I have been thinking about humility, especially now that some of you, my friends, have passes, stickers from the Ministry of Works. How do you treat those who don't have stickers? That's how would you understand their world, and all that? Yeah. A good journalist, I mean, is somebody who has, in my view, a multidisciplinary understanding of issues. That's why when we were at university, we never studied mass communication, you know, journalism, just the professional skills. We also were required to have an understanding of sociology, subjects like economics, you know, political science. It was for a reason that, you know, at the end of the day, it is important for us to be able to explain things, to cover things. You can't cover things you don't understand.
You don't understand.
You know, you cannot cover labor, NSSF, or if you don't understand, you know, some of these issues around labor. You cannot cover all these debates in parliament if you don't understand the fields from which they, you know, they arise. So I think that a good journalist requires that understanding. You need to read, you know, widely, you know, read with greed and read others, those others, you know, watch others who impress you and all that. But above all, I mean, respect, you know, the views of others, be impartial. I mean, you have a point of view, there's nothing wrong with that, but, you know, be fair. I mean, when it comes to covering the news, it's not your views that matter. What matters is that you can have an accurate record of what, you know, transpired, but above all, that you can help your audiences understand what I call the so what. So what? This happened, so. This happened, therefore. That is, for me, a good journalist. Somebody who is not just a stenographer. Somebody who's not just, you know,
a typewriter.
Or these people who hold megaphones, you know. Megaphone. Yeah. Your job is not just to give the president or his ministers, you know, a pedestal to go on lecturing us. It's important for them sometimes, once in a while, like now during these COVID times, for the president to have his 1 hour or 2 hours talking directly to the public without any gatekeepers. But if you are covering that event, having given him 2 hours to talk uninterrupted, when you're covering it the following day in a story, surely your job can't be to repeat what the president said word for word. Mm. Your job now should be to help the people understand. Is there anything new the president said? Is there something different here? What does it mean? What does it add up to? Are we making progress or not? What's going on here? What seems to be the biggest concerns? What seems to be the success thus far? Where are we? Is there a direction? Is this team in charge? Should Ugandans be? Those kinds of questions, you know? And it's not up to you, the journalists, to answer those questions. You can have experts, you know, including those within the government, you know, to help you answer those kinds of questions.
Doctor, one then might wonder, do you consider journalism a sacrifice or a service?
Let me just put it this way. It doesn't have to be an either or question. You know, sometimes those binaries become very dangerous. Sacrifice or service. Why can't I serve and earn for my service? When we say journalism is public service or a public good, we're not saying that it should be done for free. Whereas it's a public good to the extent that because of its importance for the survival of our society. But it doesn't mean that those who do it shouldn't be paid. No. So journalism, you can. Yes, I say it is public service, but it is service too. But I think those who, you know, are in it should be paid. Now, having said that, if you're asking me, would I disappear? Would I go away because I wasn't being paid? Maybe no. If you ask me, that is not the highest on my agenda of, you know, when I rank jobs, the issue of pay is not one of them. I mean, the top. Now, of course, I can afford to say that. Maybe you can say that, you know, because my children are older than some of yours, you know, so some of you, if you have children. Do you have children?
Yes,
yes. So you know, yeah, but mine, I'm definitely sure they are older than yours, you know. So, and I now have to surmount, you know, to the university, you know, bills and all that, but that's a different story. For me, the satisfaction comes from those other issues we were discussing, you know, the potential impact of my work, those kinds of things, my independence, my autonomy as I'm doing this work. Those are more important considerations for me than how much, you know, is written on my paycheck.
But
yeah. I think that especially to my young friends in the media, you know, you should stand up for your rights, absolutely. You should not in any way allow people to lecture you about sacrifice and all, you know. But at the same time, you need to be good listeners, you know, because sometimes some of these people have a point, you know. Platforms like this, quite frankly, offer you opportunities you won't find in very many other places. If you are a very serious person, believe you or me, you are going to take away, you know, a lot from this kind of platform. So maximize what you can take away from this place. You know, I'm not saying you should just, you know, try and negotiate, try and earn your worth, what is your worth, but at the end of it all, also understand and appreciate that which you are taking away from platforms like Fusion Group, platforms, you know, like Bukhe, the Urban TV, NTV, NBS, Monitor, New Vision, and so on. It's, at the end of the day, I think it's also about your conscience, you know, as a person. And we used to be told when we were in school, you know, journalism ethics. It's not just about society or about the media institution. It is also about you, the individual. What are your limits? What are your, as an individual, you know, what works for you, what doesn't work for you? So yeah, it's a tough one. And good luck to all those who deserve, you know, better pay. I hope really that those, all of those who have been touched by within the newsrooms, by this whole drive, this whole campaign for better pay, actually deserve it. I am really hoping that, they are working people, because, I mean, sometimes you also have free riders who don't do any work, but they are also part of the people who are making noise about pay. I hope really that, the good working journalists of Uganda someday earn what they deserve. But having said that, again, like we have said over and over, we must understand that that's not going to happen if the media are not fixed at that bigger level, of sustainability, that bigger level of viability. Because, quite frankly, we don't know what media we are going to have 5 months from now, 1 year from now.
Doctor, one of the critical conversations or big conversations that happen in the newsrooms is the feeling, the gut feeling that in most cases when you're talking about, like you've ably explained,
yeah,
good journalism and things like free press, freedom of media freedom, sometimes media owners seem to be absent from this conversation. And how then can media owners be play a critical role in ensuring good journalism and freedom of the media?
First of all, who are these media owners? In our case, we are told they are either regional conglomerates, like Nation Media Group, big groups like Vision Group, which are, you know, is owned by the government and the public, you know, it's a mixed model. And for the part of radio stations, mainly politicians and religious groups. So now, again, that's, it goes back to the issue I was raising of the media paying enough attention, adequate attention, more attention to the industry, their own industry. How much debate have we had about these issues of who owns the media in this country? And what that means for regulation. I'm not even sure that, you know, for UCC, that regulates broadcast media, for instance, I'm not sure whether, you know, it is in time for us to reconsider ownership of radio stations or TV stations by politicians. Is it actually what our constitution intends when it talks about freedom of expression. To have a politician who owns a radio station that will not give access to an opponent or to others who have differing opinions or alternative points of view? I'm not sure that under our constitution, you know, that kind of practice is protected per se. I mean, I could be wrong. The point is, we cannot have answers to such pressing questions if we don't have adequate public debate. I think that debate can be pushed by the media themselves. I know that in some cases, of course, it would mean you guys shooting yourselves in the foot.
In the foot.
It may be self-defeating, but I think that in the long run, this actually, it's going to help you. The more attention you focus on your industry, the more critical attention you focus on this industry, the better for the industry in the long run, as far as I'm concerned.
Doctor, we all agree that media is central to upholding democracy and good governance in any country. But one would wonder how then, in under the circumstances that we've been discussing, how then do you strengthen this pillar? How then do you strengthen the role of the media in enhancing good governance and democracy?
First of all, and this is probably self-serving, but there are groups like ours, media support groups. You know, I think, yeah, we exert some pressure on the media, but we also provide support to the media. We train very many journalists here, Nation Media, Uganda, and elsewhere, you know, at no cost in most cases. A lot of the work that we do is funded by, you know, taxpayers in other countries. We also, you know, in terms of local efforts, I think should have far more contributions from our professional associations. It is a pity that we still have, you know, the usual problems, squabbles here and there, disorganization, you know. But I think that it would help the media in some ways if we had, you know, constituent, you know, groups of journalists that are transparently elected, that are accountable, that have, you know, full-time secretariats, that can help them think about, you know, issues to do with promoting their professional fellowship and so on. I'm very happy that we recently had you know, an effort to have the Editors Guild. It is now up and running. It is, you know, chaired by Daniel Kalinaki of the National Media Group. And hopefully, yeah, they are going to have a full-blown effort at, you know, popularizing this and making it, you know, speak for media when it comes to the kind of professional issues that editors, you know, would want to actually be hired. Because sometimes you feel frustrated when you see the president and others in the government, you know, discussing professional issues of journalism with media owners and managers and not with, you know, the people who actually do the journalism. It's important that we have those groups, professional groups, that can speak up for the media, that can also, you know, sort of mobilize journalists, whether it is at the level of editors, whether it is at the level of, you know, others who are in the media, in the middle levels or the lower levels. Yeah, it's important.
I think it is very interesting that you like you pointed out, professional bodies, absence of a solid voice. And one of the things that often intrigued me is the fact that when on such days, for example, when the World Press Freedom Day comes, one of the conversations that might come up is human rights for journalists, and in most cases, the reference points are, for example, you would say ACME, who is a media trainer, and under normal circumstances shouldn't be the one advocating for rights. But what then causes this kind of distortion? Is it, some people would say, is the industry just disorganized? Is it just too amorphous to be able to galvanize the energies around that so that you can advocate for something that is tangible?
No, actually, just to correct the record, ACME does actually have three strategic pillars, and one of them is promoting excellence through training and, you know, the like. The other one is, you know, on media literacy, you know, for the public and, you know, other groups, you know, civil society and the like. And then we have something on advocacy for a freer environment for media. So we do have that as our mandate. But I hear you. I think that there are far more groups that should be doing this. And I don't want to speak for them. We have, for the last 4 years, tried to take a lead, for instance, on this whole issue of World Press Freedom Day, to try and bring them together so we can have, you know, events together instead of having, you know, duplicating activities and all that. Of course, there are still a few who are parochial. Mm-hmm. They will disappear and organize, even as they are enjoying the benefits of being with you, they will still disappear and do their own small things here and there. I think that is really small-mindedness, and I think that it's not something that, you know, helps many people. But you would hope that you know, those who are concerned within the industry at the level of editors, at the level of managers, and that they are going to continue, you know, listening to those voices that are calling for far more coordination and far more, you know, seriousness on the part of the industry.
Doctor, as we wind up, how do you see the media post-COVID-19? What is the media going to look like?
First of all, I don't know. But I can guess. We would have wished to have an even stronger media because of this challenge. Unfortunately, we are going to have a weaker media because layoffs are going to be inevitable for some of these media houses. There's no way they are going to be able to pay the wage bill when they are not earning adequately. You know, of course, in a few cases, you could say that COVID has also exposed new ways of doing business, so they could save money here and there. Instead of having to come for me at home like you did today, maybe you can interview me via Zoom, save money for the driver who came for me,
then they
and
have
the
to
fuel and off. Have to drop me. I'm hoping you're not going to leave me on the
no, we shall not leave you on the street.
Yes, those kinds of things. So, but I don't know. But the thing is, yeah, the challenges that the media were facing before COVID, the financial, the economic challenge, you know, it has just been aggravated by COVID. And so tomorrow, by tomorrow I mean 5 months from now, a year from now, we should be discussing these, the possibilities, you know, and there are many possibilities of, for instance, public funding for some form of journalism, you know, public interest journalism especially. It happens in some other countries, you know, that there's nothing wrong with putting public money to causes like journalism that is going to help us strengthen our education, strengthen our health sector, you know, environment and those kind of sectors. Why can't you can have a fund? Say we will support government funding, state funding for private media houses, not just public media houses, but private media houses that fulfill the following conditions. I think that we can have a debate as stakeholders, you know, across the board. We can have a debate on some of these issues. A lot of our money has in the past been given to all sorts of causes, some of them quite frankly dubious. You know, private companies have received government money, you know, for support. Why can't media, especially media that have shown or can show that they are going to put this money to good use, that they are going to produce public goods, as it were, why can't they, you know, get some of this money?
Doctor, could you help us paint a picture of how we can leap forward in terms of the challenges post-COVID and also the monster called fake news? We are operating in a world where you're competing to give real information, accurate information, but you're competing with a platform that has a wider audience, but in most cases with disinformation. How can we move forward?
No, I think that disinformation, you know, that is a big monster, and it is going to swallow us if we are not careful. The media have a role to play, obviously. The media can help, you know, fight disinformation, misinformation by, for instance, you know, fact-checking some of these, you know, claims that we see on social media and elsewhere. But that's also a problem because on the one hand, while fact-checking has its benefits, it also then means the media is taken away from paying attention to other important tasks to now cross-check the public record, you know, to sort of cross-check what has been put on the public record.
Dr. Peter, thank you for making it to Checkpoint. That's all we had for you today. Be sure to catch us tomorrow, same time. Keep it urban.